Good evening. Welcome to the one of the unusual lectures of this series. We have had the honor to have Gaetano Pesce visiting LA and coming to SIARC tonight. I would like to apologize on behalf of Neil Denari for not being here tonight to introduce him. He had some issues that he had to take care of, and he regrets not being here. And I voluntarily covered this his position to do this because I haven't had the honor to actually meet him personally, but I have had the honor to know him almost all my life. When I first moved to Florence in 1972, in the architecture scene of Italy, or for that, in that respect, in Europe, there were not that many people that you could sort of see at the level of Gaetano Pesce. The most innovative, creative person with great abilities to touch many people's life, and many designers like myself, young and very young students of architecture, in many ways, far beyond his abilities or maybe his desire. And this has been quite a learning process for at least my generation of architects. The issues of that he introduced probably in architecture, right now they're becoming slowly very, for the lack of the better word, more in the mainstream of architecture. His fascination with human body, or the body of the architecture and space, has been quite a remarkable innovation. I can remember many projects, many installations, mostly the ones that comes to my mind especially is one that he did at the Museum of Modern Art, and his installation at the University of Venice, University of Milan, many more. He was born in La Spezia in 1939, and from a musician mother and a captain of navy father. Very early as a young man, he loses his father, and his interest in architecture grows beyond everybody's imagination. He has been praised and criticized by his peers in Italy, but very well respected for continuing to develop a series of ideas that, and he probably would show a great deal of it tonight to us. In 1959, he commenced his studies of architecture at the Faculty of Architecture of University of Venice, and from 1961 to 1965, he attended the New Venice College of Industrial Design. His innovations in materials is probably familiar to most of us, we can probably say without any exaggeration that he probably is the most innovative person in the industrial design today. His teachers include Carlo Scarpa and Ernest Roger, Mario Bellini, and his students probably, we can just imagine that his innovation probably in the materials influenced the whole industrial design in Italy and the world. It's quite a pleasure to have him here today So without me taking any of his time, please welcome Gaetano Pesce.
Thank you, Michele. Thank you very much. Good evening. Thank you very much to Michele. I have no word when people talk like he did. I have no idea what I have to say, because what I do is just something that I like. And I don't know if it's important, etc. But I am grateful to Michele to express certain words toward my work. Second, Margie, thank you very much for what you did to invite me here. It's a pleasure to be with you. And thank you also to Andrea, who took me around this morning and seeing, for instance, something very emotional, that is the Eames House, which is extraordinary. I mean, I was really moved by that. So thank you, Andrea. I don't know where she is, but she must be around. Look, coming here, I saw a little poster, a photocopy of a picture of me with the gas mask or mask gas. So I asked to Margie where they had that picture and if you know what that means. And they said, she said, maybe because you work with certain material. No, I don't work with dangerous material, and there are not really, yes, there are some dangerous material. But not, it's not the case for me. That was a lecture that happened maybe 20 years ago, when there was the moment of the postmodern movement starting, and they invite some architects like Pozan Park, Jean Nouvel. I was in Paris at that time, and other, I remember, we were five. But me knowing that we were going to talk about postmodernism, I thought that the air was a poison. And so I went from the audience, I waited a little bit, I put my mask, and then I joined the others. My chair was empty, waiting for me, and the others were not able to talk because the mask was doing kind of noise that nobody was able to talk. And me, I just said inside the mask in an incomprehensible way from the words, but they understood what I was saying, that revisit the past and look into the past and be in love with the past is very dangerous, much more dangerous than certain material that we have today. So that is the explanation for that. Now the postmodern, I think, is really dead. And then there are more and more people like you, I think, looking to the future. So let me say again, it's a pleasure to be in a school like this one, where I understood you do a lot of research and you are quite curious people. This is very good. I mean, I don't know if it's important for you here that is important to look, but I think it's really, progress is not just a word, it's something very important to achieve. So what I can tell you, because until, I don't know, I have my work to show you in a kind of confusion. I studied in Venice, I had good teachers, very good. But I must say that I fight them very much, because I was used to tell them that a good teacher never teach what she or he knows. A very good teacher teach usually what he doesn't know. And that is the definition of research, the best I know. We don't know where we go, but with our doing things, we allow the future to become present. And that is fantastic. And me, I was fighting my Gardella or Scarpa or other people. Very important. I respect them a lot. But because it was difficult for me to learn something learned by someone else, that he was learning that when he was my age. And it was not easy. So, that is one thing that I wanted to tell you. Then something that worried me as a preoccupation. Okay, let's start in another way. School gave me not a lot, I must say. So, finishing the school, I was with surprise in front of a situation where I had no knowledge about present, like material from my time. And so I start to ask to chemical companies to allow me to visit and to ask to follow process. And I start to be in love with new things. And I am still in love with that. And with other things, sure. But and so that is the story. I was alone for a long time. I don't want you to cry or to make something. But it's true that I was alone, but I think our time is done with a lone figure. It's not anymore the time of currents. It's a time of solitarian birds who sing in different ways here and there. And this is beautiful. What else? I am really interested in certain questions. This is the time of question. It's not the time of answers. We have to ask where we are going, how we can be useful to a society that apparently isn't able to do without us. This is not easy to digest. In the old time, artists and architects were very, very useful. They were integrated in the society. But today, something happened. And only a little elite needs architects or artists, by the way. I don't know. Try to go with the very advanced, avant-garde expression, artistic expression in a country like China, and go to the people in the country and show, and you will discover that their art is not universal anymore. Too bad. But I think that there is another art that we are not able to recognize yet, which is already going in a new direction, where in the future we will find the existence of art. But I have confusion about that, so I don't talk more about this. But I like to talk about freedom and democracy. And with the pain, not a lot of pain, just a little bit, I see that between architecture and democracy there is no relation. Why is that? Finally, architecture is still the monument to the architect, which is not what architecture is supposed to be today at the end of the 20th century. Architecture is more something that is at the service of society everywhere in the world, and possibly talking to everybody, able to give incredible feeling that society needs. But architecture is, unfortunately, in most of the cases, very dogmatic still, very rude, monumental sometimes, making people afraid of certain machines. Think about hospital for children or school, where architecture is not able to give with the space and with the materials and with what we can have today with the fantastic technology that we have, giving people, through that, giving people pleasure. I am not discussing that functional attitude is finished. Not at all, it's there all the time. But we are supposed to give more. Not style, not dogmatic things, but we are supposed to give love. And love means that we touch a wall and it's not cold and free and cold and rigid, but I prefer a wall who is like touching another person, the skin, and I feel warm, and I see the colors, and I see translucent material, which are not glass. Glass and metal and structure like that are a discovery, and concrete, are a discovery of engineers from last century, and almost nothing come for as a material for architecture from this century. Wood is old, stone is old, etc. So my curiosity was what we can do to have material that are very small, like a child today, existing for object, why we don't do a little effort to transform that material in adult. Adult material, meaning they participate to the logic of the building. So that, and feeling means that today we need, in this moment where there is a lot of insecurity, a lot of problem, et cetera, as we know, existential problem, crisis, fault, identity. People think that without identity we suffer, which is not true. It's much better without identity, stay without identity. But in any way, we have problem in the everyday. Why not architecture decide to help people to live in a better way with the sensuality in the space, in the material, or joy, or stimulating atmosphere. And I can talk hours, but you understood what I am talking about. So dimensions that are more human, instead to make monuments. And monuments, I don't know what you think about the monument. Me, I am bored. As soon as I see a monument, I don't understand what is the reason for that. Yes, there are monuments that are important to remember, but anyway, in general, we don't need monumental architecture or stylish. Today we have no style. There is no way to continue with style. And form. What about form? Why the process of architecture starts with a new concept, with something that is innovative? And I take a fantastic example. The last piece of architecture built in New York, almost half century ago. Not bad for the capital of the 20th century, not to allow that city to have other pieces of architecture. And the last one was the Guggenheim Museum, where an architect, he was not involved with form, he was more curious about how I can move the idea of a museum which is 200 years old, at the time it was 150, because the first museum is the Louvre at the end of the 18th century. So this Frank Lloyd Wright, what he did, he said, look, I want to innovate this typology. So people are used to go and see one room after another, walking and be tired with the walk, stopping, looking, and moving, and other people pushing. I mean, it's a kind of fight today to go and see an exhibition, certain exhibition. But he conceived a fantastic idea related to the technology of the time. Elevator, so I bring people up, and then with a spire, I allow them to see a show in a very easy way, because they go down and the body is less heavy. Fantastic. And then he conceived its structure. And then at the end, what do you want? The form come up as natural, not as a main preoccupation, but as a consequence of a new concept. Fantastic. Three languages were perfect. Innovation in language, material, and also the technique or the technology they use. When you have these factors together, for sure you have a masterpiece. So this is one thing. Why I was talking about this, I forgot. But, okay, look. This is one preoccupation I have. Another preoccupation is the same thing, industrial design. We are in a moment of styling again, like architecture. It's too bad. I think the object needs to express more freedom, more unicity. It was in the 1972 when I, for the first time, I was questioning why objects have to make manufactured in series in a way where there is a guy who is there looking just the production, and as soon as an object different with the fault or something, they pull it away and they throw out. And me, I was thinking, look, this is the image of a totalitarian society where everybody is supposed to be exactly the same in mind, in way to dress, etc. And when there is a different guy, they bring him out. This is not acceptable. Freedom is the opposite. So I start to think, technologically speaking, what we can do to have a production in series where each piece is different. And I was lucky because I found ways, not only, but I found companies curious to do something like this. And maybe later I will show you images. So you see, incredibly, we can say international style, international ideology. They were going together for a long time. And so the international style was at the service of the international ideology, who was saying all the people in the world are the same, no difference in tradition, they have at the end dress in the same way. But fortunately, that dream for certain countries stay as a dream. Others, they still are, have this kind of totalitarian view. But so, thinking like this and thinking as an architect, what we have to do to try to convince our project to be a representation of democracy, for instance? And that, I think, is an important goal. And I am trying to do something in that direction. What other questions are important today? Well, anyway, they will come later. For sure, if you want to have a question, I will be happy to answer, but they already told me that there are no questions usually. But make an exception, I came from far away to listen your question, so give me a few questions tonight. Okay, let's start with this. And I show you, a kind of paradigm. I don't know if this word means something to you, but paradigm is a way to express two concepts that are opposite in certain moment, etc. So this is what I call paradigm. It's a series, and it's something special. This projection is done with three or four slides, or six or seven, and it's a kind of thing that years ago, I think in 81, I had this question. What is the relation between an art and a functional object? Because in the past, art was always functional. So think about a portrait. Portrait is a product that someone in Renaissance time was asking to a painter to do a portrait of a lover, for instance, just because I wanted to travel with a portrait of my lover and remember her. So what I was asking to this painter, not to make art or culture, I was asking to give me a product functional to me to remember the face of this dear person. So art was always that. Then when the photography came up, things went only in the direction of an art expression with unique function, which is the cultural one. But usually art was always with two functions. Art, culture, and utility. So I was talking about this series of 9 chairs done with a mold, with the material which has a different formula each time. So chair number 1 has a formula, and it changed until number 9. Characteristics are that when I do the number 1, the material has no capacity to sustain the body, the weight of the chair. So as soon as I take out from the mold, the chair collapses. And it's like a body without bone. The number 2, so what you can do in front of this chair, you cannot use it. You have to look to it. And that becomes an expression related to expressing deformation or expressing violence or expressing a body without bone. Oh, I have to maybe do this. Yes. So you need to make a structure to hold the chair standing up. The number 2 stays, but the back of the chair goes down. And again, it's something that we have to look as a sculpture or a certain expression. So only one dimension. Same thing. And the number 3 stay up, but as soon as you touch, it's like a jelly. It moves like this. And if you try to sit, you collapse with the chair. And the number 4 start to be much more okay, but not really. Each one is different in color, etc. Then number 5, I think. And that is nice, because the art piece become to be useful. But useful for who? Just for children, because their body is not so heavy. Because an adult try to sit on the chair, he collapses. So it's good, it's a functional object for child, but it's still expression for adult. Then number 6. I know, I went. Yeah, number 6, you sit very comfortable. Why? Because it's elastic, it's like a membrane. Any kind of body can find comfort sitting there. And you still have a certain impression of instability, insecurity. So it's nice, because our time is done with insecurity and instability. Then number 7 is okay. And then, detail. The chair has a lot of little things expressing what means to do a chair like this. It's a trip, a traveling in an unknown landscape, is a kind of belief or religion, is a mechanical, arithmetic also problem. Other detail. Oh. Anyway, there are details like two bodies making love in a certain corner, because to do a chair like this means that you is a kind of making love with an object, which is opposite now, but you can recognize that anyway. amici. Anyway, there is nothing else until when the number 8 start to be too rigid and the back is not folding, and so you start to have something bothering you. And the number 9 is impossible because really is uncomfortable. So you see, art and design, they can go together. I mean, I would say function and art, they pragmatic things and culture, they can go together if you have an object like this. And it depends sometimes of the chemical formula. So this is a question: what is art today? And then when you change the chemical formula, the art becomes functional, and then when you change the chemical formula, start to become again something that you have to look. Anyway, I don't want to talk more about this, but yes, to do an object like this, in Italy when we do this, means that we need good luck. So that was also when you do any research, you need good luck to arrive until the end. I think if you can push the projector from there, and me, I tell you next, we can work better. What do you think? Okay, a nice view of the certain chair. Okay, next. Okay, let's go with the time when I was taking a shower one day, and I was using a sponge, and I was looking the sponge, and the sponge, as soon as I released the sponge came back to the original volume. So I said, what about to do a chair in that material with no structure that I can package under vacuum so I can send and sell, etc. So this is a chair this high. The packaging in the PVC envelope, the box, and it was sold like that. It was a bomb, technologically speaking, and a magic surprise for people. The company in question accepted to do it. They were happy to do it because it was an incredible discovery for them. Imagine for storing chairs and transporting chairs was much easier and less expensive. So me, I had the freedom. I was 29, I think. No, 28. We are in 68, the project, 69, the production. And I had the freedom to express myself. Usually, until this time, an object is never capable to say anything about meaning of the designer or the artist or whatever. Take the chair. If I ask you who and where this chair was designed and what identity represents, we know about functionality, good utilization of material. We don't know a lot. But in this case, if you observe that form, you recognize a female body. And then you look about the ottoman, which is round, and you recognize that is the image of a prisoner. You know the old prisoner, he was walking with a ball in metal attached. So it's the same image that the women in the history were always prisoners of prejudice. And me, I said, look, why we talk about certain problem with traditional media instead to talk about that with the industrial object, who goes to people, they have comfort because it's a very comfortable chair, but then if you want to understand, they understand that the industrial object can carry political, for instance, point of view. And this is what I did. That is 69. Next. Yes, next. This is the envelope. Oh, someone opening the envelope. Immediately the chair come up. And next. Like a sponge. Yeah, this is the final product. Next. recycle rug chair, rugs connected with rubber. And I did a chair like this, and it's a chair, very heavy, but it was the same time, more 72 or 73, next. Recycled chair with the rest of a place in Seoul where they cut clothing, and they threw out this, so we use it for chairs in the workshop. Next. Oh, this is one of the second example of what I told you, a chair that is never the same, is always different, is similar, one piece to another, because the technology I used, it was a technology sensitive to the changement of the pressure or the temperature in the room where they work, so each chair is similar. So the same, exactly the same kind of, oh, it's interesting to say, I don't know if you follow me, but here there are pleats. And up there, where you need to sit, there are no pleats. So the polyurethane foam expanding goes in the pleats, and there is no way to expand, so it stays very rigid. And where the polyurethane can expand, you have the soft part, which are the seat and the back. And the pleats make the structure of the chair. So there is nothing than foam and fabric. And the fabric is the mold of the chair, so it's a very inexpensive process. But in this way, I was able to do chairs that are always different. Like a surprise, like when you cook bread and you go to the oven, when it's cooked, you open the oven and you have a surprise of the form of your bread, which is not due to your will, but is due to the material. And I like that. Usually material have to be free to realize itself around 40 or 50%. And the rest is your will. So next, table done in the same way. There is no way to have a similar table in a production where you pour resin in a simple mold. Resin is liquid, goes in a way that the resin wants. 20 minutes the cure, the material, resin becomes rigid. You take out from the mold and you have a monolithic table, which is always the same, which is never the same, and the top is always different. Sometimes it's more or less a square, sometimes it's a... So imagine the clients that went in a showroom saying, I want to have a table like this. And the answer was, no way, because it's always different. So, fantastic, you know, to have people bought this table, opening their mind and accepting the concept of the surprise. Fantastic. Next. A sweater I designed for a company in France, because I like very much to change. No, routine is a horrible thing. If you work always with the media, at a certain moment you are tired. So it's good to change house and go in another place where you do other experience, a different scale, who refresh your mind. Next. Okay, here is a company, vases, flexible. They look like glass, but you can play soccer with them because they are elastic and they are very strong, elastic, flexible, etc. Next. Yes, same thing. Next. Spaghetti vases, same thing. You can throw out from the window of a skyscraper and they jump downstairs like this. So what I am talking about now, I am talking about that between the traditional glass and the material from our time, you have more or less the same result from the visual point of view. But then when you touch it, you have this incredible surprise, it's elastic. And then you can send this vase to a friend in Tokyo just with the sticker, with the address and the stamp, because it's not fragile. But if you want to send a piece of glass You need insurance, you need a special packaging, and usually your eye is broken. So this is the progress. This is really a progress. Not only that, but let me talk about something else. Maybe in the next slide. Let's see if I have... Yes. Let's talk about what I call poorly done. This is another fixation of certain architects. The beauty of certain designers. The beauty have to be our goal. Who said that? When you talk to someone in Tokyo, he has an idea of beauty. And when you talk to a Parisian, it's another idea of beauty. And here we have another idea of beauty. So why we talk about beauty? Let's think as a people make projects, think that the most large part of the main force, the labor force in the world, 78%, has no skill. But they have the right to make money with their work. So what we have to do in front of this problem? We have to conceive projects that they are badly executed. But in a way that when they are badly executed, they become beautiful. This is the... Usually, when you do a bad object that is not so beautiful, in the tradition, people were throwing it away. Here, any mistake you do, you can throw material, you can do everything, you can close your eyes and do this, but at the end, it's always beautiful, because it's the characteristic of the object, and it's the characteristic of certain construction I did, that they are surprising and new, but they are not perfect, but that imperfection becomes the characteristic and the beauty. And it's true that our reality is non-perfect. So those objects represent better the historical moment. Also, this is, sure, is elastic, but you can enjoy, there are people who are enjoying this. Not a lot, but there are. So next. Lamp for the wall. Next. Bracelet in gold. I enjoy to work with gold very much, but it's elastic gold. And you touch those and they are really elastic. And it's a surprise, no? People think it's gold, yes, it's gold, and they touch and it's elastic. Fantastic. Next. Tray. Okay, next. It's not so interesting. Yeah, gold vase. Same thing, elastic. Then. Umbrella chair that you hang on the wall, and when you have people coming at the without calling before, you take a chair, you push a button, and boom, the umbrella open, and you have a chair. Next. This is a museum from 18th century, so big in space, they restore this museum in France, north of France, in Lille. And the entrance, there are two entrances. And the entrances are so big in scale that they had no idea what to do. They asked me, and me, I suggest a big chandelier. It's so big that there is a space for 20 people cleaning every 6 months for maintenance, the glass. It's done in pieces, broken glass, a metal structure. And it's quite, I must say, I was happy. I was very lucky because it was easy to make a mistake in the scale of the building, but they are okay, I think. Next. Yeah, you see, this is one and this is the other one. Next. Oh, here we talk about architecture and democracy. Now you are going to say, look, this guy is crazy, but he's not so crazy, finally. Society, I mean, democracy is done with a structure. It's like a structure of Los Angeles or New York, where you have a a certain pattern that is the structure of the society. And then you have a building that is this big, and then you have another one that is big like this. So you have a difference in the city. At a certain moment, representing the difference of people, different of business, different of historical difference, etc. This is the city. But in this case, is a project that I was doing with, in São Paulo with a builder, and then he was stuck because of a crisis, economical crisis, but now I think we start again. I'm doing the same project for the city of Rome for the year 2000, and another city in France, in Normandy. So I am trying. But the concept is this. This is the grid of the society. It is a tower where you buy a land. It's like when someone buy a land, you have a land and you call the architect, you say, look, we are a family of five people, we need this many bathrooms and we need this and that, and this is our taste, and I don't know what they want to say to the architect, and the architect does a project. It's the same thing, but it's the only difference is that the land is up there. So you have a platform, that one, with all the services you need, and here are the elevators and stairs, security, etc. And this is, each one is related with the other platform. And this is a garden, individual gardens. But São Paulo has a very good weather, like more or less here. So the idea was to grow gardens like a vertical gardens. And that was a certain idea that I developed further for other projects. Anyway, next. So you have each one is worked by a different architect. There were 18 architects called to work on the Brazilian architects. Me, I did almost nothing. I was happy to work only the concept, and that was enough for me. What else? Nothing. Next. And so, the vertical garden, the apartments, etc. Then the crisis stopped this project. But, you know, I mean, it's another story. Why abstraction? Let's talk about abstraction and representation of something recognizable. We come from abstraction. We have a long tradition of abstraction. But people need images to recognize what they are, what they understand, etc. So I am sure that someone living here from outside, they know I am there. In front of Central Towers today, yeah, I remember, I was living at the 19th floor in a tower in Paris at a certain moment of my life. I was always looking to this tower, trying to understand where I was. Where was my apartment? Because there was no connection. And that is not very good. I think today people ask this kind of relation, straight relation between architecture and themselves. Where is their space and that kind of things. So this is, I believe, the future of a certain architectural market. Next. A building where I apply this idea of the vertical garden. Any city, I don't know Los Angeles, but needs gardens, as you know. But sometimes the ground in a city is very expensive, so we cannot make gardens because it's too expensive. But what about making a vertical garden that can grow on the wall of a building? And it's vertical up there, it's useful. In fact, this is a building, office building in Osaka. It's red because I don't understand why Osaka is all white and gray. And here, next. And this is done 6 years ago. Each of those containers are pieces like this. They can grow trees. And they told me that Now the trees are in the facade, and the city of Osaka accepts to pay for the maintenance, which is not a lot. Maintenance for the trees growing in the facade, because they consider this vertical garden public utility. So that was nice. So it's not a great, it's nothing great, but it's important to take care of certain needs and try to answer with a kind of innovation. Next. This is a big show I had at the Pompidou Center last year. This is the entrance at the Pompidou Center is here. The entrance is here, people. This is the forum space, so I had this huge space and the basement for 37 years of my work. It was a retrospective. And I did it in a way that it was more a question mark about what I said before, the characteristic, a sign, the most close to the characteristic of our time, I think, as intellectual, is a question mark. So the show was this huge question mark, showing objects, projects, models inside, because it was very tall. Okay, next. This is a wall all around, done with stone of our time. They are packaging of fabric that goes from Europe to China to be recycled. Me, I rent those, so it was not expensive to do a wall like this, to have a kind of strong wall like the old buildings, temples, etc., but done in a way that is typical today, recycled material. So inside that, there was a show. Next. So this, you see the question mark here, with the floor that I am used to do in my project, which maybe later I talk about that. So next. Oh, this is the book, the catalog, which was done like, this is open catalog, but you have a question mark and a hole here. The cover is always the same. So it was nice to go in the library at the Pompidou Center and see people wanted to buy a catalog. They were not saying, give me a catalog. They were saying, show me 20 catalogs and I want to choose. Because they were choosing, because each one is unique. It's different color, different in shape, etc. So it's good to see that people, when they can, they like to choose. So next. Me doing the next, doing the floor. Anyway, I like to tell you one thing. The show was done with this concept, not a show with things very clear. You go inside, you see everything, and then you. It was done with a certain mechanism that the show was visible 30% for each visit, and every 2-3 days it was changing, showing another 30% with curtain going in front of drawings, object models, and bubbles was inflated certain days and non-inflated other days, so they were collapsing against models, a project, etc. Light was disappearing for 2 or 3 days in certain parts, so the people saw only certain things. Like you visit a city, and you visit a part of the city, and you leave it with the idea that you are knowing one part, or maybe you have to come back if you want to know more. The show is the same thing. I think it's boring the way we show today, where everything is clear, white wall, and then you have painting, you have sculpture. That is 200 years old, and I don't think is good for today. So the Pompidou was done like that, and it was very nice, because some people didn't realize that there was that mechanism. So they were going a lot to the direction of the museum and protesting because the maintenance was not good. The light is not working. There are curtains in front of the art. So what is this museum? It was nice. Because to create that kind of, so This is a end of an article I did maybe 12 years ago, when at the end I say our time is the time where shoes look like sofa and sofa look like shoes. And finally I did this, and it's a nice, comfortable sofa. Next. Yeah, next. This is again a simple object done with a very simple technology. It's a piece of felt where they project resin. The felt absorbs the resin where you need the structure. So this part here, here, and all this part. So when the resin cures, is the structure of the chair. Where you need softness, is just felt. And it's nice, I like to call it chair for a television, because you look at the television, you start to sleep, maybe it's a little cold, and you close the chair like a coat. Next. Yeah, this is a nice image of that chair, which a quilt that when you need to wash, you can detach it. Next. Bottle, mineral water. So it's too long now. I don't think I want to finish in an hour, so I go fast. This is a bottle that is not a traditional bottle. It's a bottle that is sold for mineral water like this. Two parts that goes one inside the other. So you have a perfect cube in one way, a kind of cube. So you don't lose space in the transportation, shipment, etc. Is an image of the pure water in the inclined part inside, in the diagonal, because it represents the source, and they say the water comes from the mountain, where the water is pure. I don't believe that, but in any way, I don't think water comes from the mountains. But that was okay, nothing else. Next. Production of this bottle. Next. Yeah, this is a little opposite, but that doesn't matter. Look, this is a project of a center for children at La Villette, Parc de la Villette in Paris, and it was stopped because I was trying to use innovative material. As you know, sometimes we cannot do that because of rules. So fire people said, no, this is not possible. It was done with different kind of, like this. This was a little library, 3 floors, where the wall was supposed to be done with elastic resin. Elastic is a way to say, almost rigid resin, in a way that when you have nobody inside the building is perfect. But then when you have children going in the morning to the second floor, to the third floor, and they are 40 or 50 or 100, the building deforms a little bit. Showing what the styles were used to do in the past. Corinthian order or Doric order were showing that going up the building becomes lighter. In this case, you don't need the order, style, etc. The materials itself is showing that going up the building is lighter and is also used by people. So you can say inside there are people because it's deformed. And when nobody is going in the library in the night, he's standing up perfect. So imagine, think like this, which are not expensive. It's possible to find a chemical company giving the material for free just to test the market of the future. But the rules fire people, they said, no, this is not possible. This was a tower done, I think I have an image later, in blocks of polyurethane, rigid polyurethane foam, very light. So it was a center for children where I tried to use children material in a construction. But they said you have to change the project and do it with traditional material. But it was not very interesting. So I stopped that. But it was interesting to say that at that time I was thinking, yes, abstraction is over, and we need to see. But the Parc de la Villette was an empty space at that time, and no relation with the site, no relation with the identity of the place. So I made a relation with the user of this center for children, which is a body running, which is a typical way to be when children move around. So the body is there to, for sure, when you are inside, you don't see the body, but you feel, like the Celts place, you don't see the horse, you don't see, I don't know what, but you feel that curve or that line is human, I believe, I don't know. Next. So this is the, yes, this is the block. Or you're the, okay, let's go. This is the model. Next. European, a collector asked me to design 15 European tables, representing each one, a country. So here you have a map of, I don't know what, I don't remember. But the legs are a question mark. Because it's again a political, little political statement. We talk about European unification from a long time, but I don't believe that politicians are doing the right work to make Europe unified. So Europe is still non-unified, and this table is expressing that with the question mark. When all the tables are together, you have a Europe who's standing on question marks, and they are a little soft. So when you push on the table moves a little bit, so it's the instability of Europe. Next. Italy, this I recognize. Yeah, this is a beautiful country, I like it very much. Next. This is the tower with blocks, where is a way to conceive a production of blocks, this big, very light, very strong, easy to manipulate in the place where they work, and each one outside is conceiving a production where each outside face is always different. So there is a way to build a wall like this. It was a prototype of a kind of space. Next. Next. So this is the inside part. Next. Showroom for children. So the children, they go to buy clothing, usually with a father. No, you know that. No, it's not true. They go usually with a mother. Why you don't say they go with a mother? So the mother is there, going with the child, or the boy, or the girl, to buy things. So the door for the mother is a normal size. But the door for the children is this big. And it's a way for me to talk about an old iconography, Italian art, the Madonna with the child, is very beautiful sometimes. So it was a way to make a door of this showroom connecting with that identity or that iconography. It's done with a soft resin, translucent, etc. The floor, which I more or less, I don't want to say invented, but I created in a certain way, is the mosaic of our time, I think, because it's a resin that you, is liquid. You go in a room like this, you have an hour to make sign, to make drawings, anything you want. Or maybe you leave it in the color like it is. But in a showroom or in an office, you can put, or in a house, you can put sign, arrow saying toilet, that direction. You have a beautiful view there from a window. You can put, you are here, narrow, saying you are here in front of a beautiful view, or things like that. So the floor talk is not decorative. It's a service to give information. And it's done with a nice material, non-expensive, very low maintenance. And it's a way to have a personalized floor. Okay, next. So he's in an expensive showroom with a metal grid, industrial grids, covered with quilt, where you have symbol of what they sell on the other side of the shelf. So it's nothing very... Next. Oh, this is a wall, elastic wall, where I discovered the children, they enjoy so much to see this wall. It looks rigid, it looks strange because it's translucent, full of color. Then they start to touch and they see that it's a wall which is elastic. And they start to push the wall. So imagine, if I want to push this wall, I break my hand. But if they jump against that wall running, the wall bend and then he come back. So it was a pleasure to see children playing with this. Practically, it's a symbol of a man and a woman, which is a symbol of the toilet, meaning from this part of the showroom, if you need to go to the toilet, you see the symbol and you go to the toilet. But in reality, it was a toy for children to show that a wall is not anymore this rude, how you say, obstacle element that if we want to jump against it, we break our neck. No, it's not. It's elastic with belt on the top. And when you move, you have the belt, what, singing? Or else? Yeah. So that was a nice experience. Next. The stairs done with the liquid resin flow, showing the movement of the material going down to the stairs. Next. Yeah, handle door, soft. Next. Office I did in New York for Chaya Day. Nice experience, very good client, intelligent, because unfortunately I have to work with special clients all the time because certain people don't think that this is a easy work, so they are worried about this, but so I needed special people. And this one was a special guy, and I did a nice work. It was the first, with another one here in Los Angeles for the same company, Chaya Day. I did the one in the same time in New York. So it's the first virtual office where people go in the morning, they live in a cabinet who has all a different face. It's like a forest of people. You leave your personal things and then you go with your computer where you like every day with no desk and nothing. Only corners, chairs where you can sit, plugging your computer and working where you like. Here is something that I decide to do, the client accepts, it's unusable. It's not necessary, but finally people find it very necessary because it's like in the piazza, and you have this where people go, they like to sit on that. They move around, they pull that stairs where they like, and they stay like this, and they talk with a friend. So it's something totally unusual who became very used by people working there. Next. And the floor, as you saw, is like a floor. This is a wall of a space where inside they need a special space because they work with the remote control, put it together, tapes, etc. So the wall is like brick wall, but the brick is a remote control done in plaster. So we did a production of that. And it's a way to say, look, this abstract wall is not telling me what there is behind. What is the function of the space behind? In this case, you look at remote control and more or less you understand that behind they work with remote control, TV, etc. This is a carrel for very heavy computers, so they cannot carry in the morning. So they pull the carrel where they want, and they plug on the floor. Next. The coffee shop where they go, they plug their computer, they eat a panino, and they sandwich and a salad, and they work and they do what they want. They receive fans. Fantastic. This was also a good compliment to me, because they told me that people, before they were leaving and meeting friends in the bar around the area of Wall Street, and they start to see that when they move in this office, people were inviting friends to have a drink in the office, staying after six. So the floor is here. We are in the coffee shop. You see a cup with a dish, with a coffee, warm coffee, etc., a sandwich. So the floor is talking about the function of the space where you are, etc. Next. Where you need to be more than one to do the job or to do a certain project. You have big tables in the space like this where you can sit also with 12 of you, etc. Next. Doors are flexible. This is a room of presentation ideas to the client, so they need to be in a private space. So the lamps represent the nature of the ideas who goes in all the directions. Next. This is a gallery in Belgium, very narrow space. You go in a gallery, you have eventually one piece there, but nothing else. And then people discover that here there are silhouettes of something that they are intrigued by, and they see holes like a handle. Next. So they pull and they open doors and they see the exhibition. As soon as you open the door, light appears and you discover an exhibition. If you open 10 doors, you see a certain exhibition. If you open 20, another. 25, 30. If you open all the doors and you have the passion to do that, they are 78, it's a big work. So certain people go open certain door and that's it. It's okay if they don't see everything. Next. It was always a try to question how we can show art. Here is an apartment in Manhattan. I mean, I have only this image. But just to say, this we are here. We are in the dining room. We go in that space, we see symbol of food, so we understand that that is the dining room. So it's a way to make the space enjoyable, creating colors, and those drawings are also pretty special, because it's not exactly the will of the person who makes the drawing, because you draw with the same material on a liquid, and so the liquid moves. So you do a drawing, and then you go after another, and you have another. It's a surprise. The material participates to the process. Next. This is a fantastic piece that I was very lucky to do. It's a glass piece done with a technique that doesn't exist until 7 years ago. So, thinking about the origin of glass, I thought one day someone did a dinner on the beach a million years ago, I don't know. And they made a big fire cooking something, and then they went to sleep. The fire was still there in front of the sea, and they came back the day after, and in the day they saw a strange piece of sand, but the sand was not the sand. It was a solid, lucent piece, like a stone, translucent. So they discovered the glass. I believe in this way. Thinking about that, when this is done in a research center for glass in France, it's a public center, government pay for that. And so they invite me to research in glass, and I came up with this idea that you have a gun connected with the compressed air. The air goes to the gun, but in the meantime absorbs a very thin sand in a pipe with the air who goes through the gun. At the end of the gun, you have a flame at 1100 degrees. So as soon the sand goes through the flame, becomes liquid. So you can spray glass at high temperature in a kind of mold that I found, a kind of artificial cotton resisting to the high temperature. And so you can do shape like this. This is a mask, but this is also a flower pot or flower vase because the nose is empty. This piece is this big, more or less. It's very light because it's very thin. And inside the nose, you can put, on the other side, you can put water and flowers. But if you want to do a piece like this with a traditional technique that is or pouring glass or blowing, it's not possible. So it was a pleasure to see that researching, we can add new technique to this very old material. Also after centuries and centuries that when people are working with this material, it's always possible to make an innovation. Next. Recycled beer bottle, making a plate or a vase or whatever. Next. Broken glass, making a vase. Or recycled. Next. Thank you very much. It's finished. Thank you. Thank you, Michele.
It was a pleasure.
Oh, yes. If you have questions, with pleasure. Yes, I have a nice story. Oh, the question is, if I make research or experiments with composite material like ceramic or carbon fiber, and I have a nice story here, which is, years ago, I was thinking that ceramic is a fantastic material, but it's always the same from a long time. And I thought, why I don't research in a way of elastic ceramic? Because I can make incredible things as soon as... And so usually what happened, because I have an office, I don't know how talk about my office, because I am not in the control of the office from a long time. They do what they want, and me, I prefer my freedom, and the office do that. And I have three places where sometimes I go, and when I go in the workshop, usually it's this. I have an idea, I discuss with people, and we say, look, at the beginning, this was at the beginning, I was calling chemical company saying, do you have a new material? Can you send me a kilo that we can make experiments? And they usually were saying, look, we have material like this, et cetera, but it's for military use. We cannot tell you how to use it. So we say, okay, send it, we try it. And we made a lot of mistakes, but doing the mistake, we discover things that were not in the rules. And that it was a great, sometimes we had great moments discovering new use. This is the way we work a little bit. I work. I call companies. So when I was thinking, it was maybe 10 years ago, about elastic ceramic, we did the same thing. We call around, do you know if there is someone who is researching? And some answers were very surprised. No, no, you look for something that doesn't exist. But at a certain moment, someone react saying, I know that there is a center in Chicago where they research on elastic ceramic. So we called, and we understood that they were very surprised receiving a call from architects saying, we would like to know about elastic ceramic, because it was a military secret, and it was a center working for military or for NASA space, you know, shuttle, that kind of thing. So they didn't trust us. But then we start to say, look, we send you the fax, we show you what we do. So we became not, they were not trusting really, but they sympathized with us. And so we start to talk about elastic ceramic in the telephone. And it was fantastic. I said, look, it's fantastic. Now I have really something new. And then, like always, I said, can you send us a pound and just allow us to make an experience and see what we can do? And the guy said, yes, for sure. But that takes 6 months to make a pound. And from the point of view of cost, is $500,000. I said, okay, forget. But it was nice to see that there is someone researching something super expensive that maybe in 20 years we buy that pot in a color where they sell painting for making ceramic, elastic ceramic for children. Sometimes we are lucky, we are able to find material which are not expensive, but sometimes new material are expensive. And that is a nice story. $500,000 for a pound. Yeah, I don't know, I answered that. Carbon, no, I don't use that. Because I use material which are alive. I use material who doesn't need molds. Because molds are expensive. And when you go to a company with an innovation and you pretend they pay for investing in molds that are expensive, your innovation has no way to see life one day. But if you go with simple way, simple material, and they can understand that to verify your innovation costs almost nothing, they follow you. And usually I use material that doesn't need molds, usually, most of the time. So the question arrived. I thank you very much and have a good dinner and see you soon.